pleasure and a privilege to have the opportunity to speak to you and tell you a little bit more about what I work on. So I have been working since my PhD on two problems that pertain to understanding the cosmic inventory of our universe. So the first problem that I've been working on is trying to understand the detailed distribution of dark matter in the universe. It turns out that the bulk of the matter in the universe, the matter content, 95% or so of the matter content of the universe, is not ordinary atoms that you and I are made of. Rather, it is some exotic kind of particle which probably formed quite early in the universe, likely before the first 3 minutes. Okay, and we do not know, we know it constitutes the bulk of the matter, as I mentioned, but we do not know what it is precisely made of, what that particular particle is, what the mass of that particle is. What we do know is that whatever that particle is, it has mass, therefore it interacts with gravity primarily, and it appears to have no charge because it doesn't have charged interaction, so it doesn't have electromagnetic interactions. So it doesn't relate to other atoms and nuclei in normal ways. So it just sits there gravitating away. So I'm often accused of working on, my colleagues tease me that what seems to appeal to me are sort of the exotica in the universe. So be it. Yes, I am interested in exotica in the universe. And before I move on to talking about dark matter, I'm very, very excited about a slightly different result in another, the other problem that I work on, which is trying to understand the formation and growth of black holes in the universe. So I recently, less than a week ago, we had a very nice paper in Science. So I'm very tempted to give you, just sort of bursting with enthusiasm, to tell you a little bit about what this new result is before I move on. So there was a press release from Yale, and it garnered a lot of press interest, you know, sort of popular press interest, because of course it has to do with black holes. So what is very exciting about this result, again, you know, driven by Hubble and other space telescopes, is that we know and understand reasonably well the life cycle of a black hole in the universe, how they form, how they grow, how they switch on, as it were, and then they switch on when they're actually fed by gas, and then they switch off, and then they're basically dead. And so I've personally worked on 3 of the 4 pieces of this puzzle, and this was the 3rd piece. There's one piece that still remains to be done. So I'm very excited because we're sort of filling in the gaps, and what the gaps are really is that the growth spurts of black holes exist in every galaxy, including our own. These growth spurts of black holes are triggered by mergers of galaxies, which are quite violent. You can see them there. And so these are Hubble images, Hubble Space Telescope images of extremely violent mergers. These are nearby galaxies that are merging. These are the counterparts really far away when the universe was less than a third of its current age. So it turns out that there's incontrovertible evidence that black hole growth is. So this is the only slide that I'm trying to, you know, I'm so excited I want to tell you about it. So this is what's really happening in these mergers is that you have this very violent merger of 2 galaxies. A lot of gas enters the center, triggers a growth spurt. However, this is so messy that there's a lot of dust that's obscuring the black hole as it's growing. And we did not know till recently, and this is what we did in this paper, we actually figured out how long the black hole is actually obscured, because eventually the dust gets evaporated and you end up seeing this growing black hole as a very, very bright quasar in the universe. Then it shines for about 100 million years, then it reaches an upper limit and it shuts off. And it shuts off, it turns out, it's triggered by another merger, if that happens. So this is sort of the life cycle. And this important piece, we did not know how long this obscured phase lasted for. And that's important because we need to know how long it lasts for to know how much growth actually happens concealed. Anyway, so I'll move on. That's that. So I'll move on to what I want to talk about today, which is, as you all know and as Deepthi mentioned, much of the work that I'm going to talk about has been enabled by the Hubble Space Telescope. So I personally owe a huge debt of gratitude to all the people who worked on this telescope and making this possible. So what you see here is a cluster of galaxies, which is about 1,000 galaxies. What you see as these fuzzy blobs are all galaxies. These 1,000 or so galaxies, this is a zoom in of the center cluster of galaxies, 1,000 or so galaxies are held together by the gravity of something. And it turns out that that something is actually dark matter. The mass of the stars, so there's mass in all these stars and all the galaxies, is insufficient to provide the gravity to hold this whole thing together. It turns out that clusters of galaxies, these structures that form most recently in the universe, offer tantalizing evidence, incontrovertible evidence, for the existence of huge amounts of dark matter in the universe. And the key way in which we know that there's a lot of dark matter in the universe comes from some phenomena that you can pick out by eye, looking at just this image. I'll be showing you some very beautiful images as we go along, but just to start training you, if you see carefully, even in this light, you can pick out some highly elongated, archy-like objects. They actually turn out to be images, multiple images sometimes, of the same galaxy that is behind the cluster. So the cluster of galaxies has so much mass, has so much dark matter, that it ends up bending light from background objects. Okay, and I will try to explain to you how this phenomenon works and how we can actually, we have exploited it and how we can further exploit it. So as I said, before I sort of give you the details of gravitational lensing, which is the light bending, I want to just persuade you that dark matter, we have a good inventory of dark matter, and that it forms the bulk of the matter in the universe. If you look at the entire energy density of the universe, so you all know from Einstein that mass and energy are equivalent, right? So E equals mc squared. So it makes sense to actually count up all the energy in the universe, and mass is going to be part of that. And you find that dark matter is most of the matter, but in fact, embarrassingly for us, the quantity, the energy, the source of energy that dominates the inventory is again something that's called dark, and you'll notice a pattern here. Whenever cosmologists don't know anything about something, they just append the word dark to it. So dark matter, dark energy. So we're in a pretty dark place in the universe at the moment.
What's that last slice?
This last slice is ordinary atoms. So they are baryons, they're ordinary atoms, the stuff of which we are made, all of which was synthesized inside stars. Wasn't originally made in the universe, per se. Only hydrogen and helium were synthesized in the universe, and trace amounts of lithium. Nothing more was synthesized in the early universe, and all the elements that were synthesized in the very universe were done so in the first 3 minutes. You may say, well, what's the rush? Well, there was a real rush because the universe was expanding and cooling. So it turns out for some atoms to form, the binding energies are such that once you cool beyond a certain point, you can't form them anymore. So the universe, as it cools and expands, terminates the formation of all elements up to say lithium 7 in the first 3 minutes, and everything else that's heavier forms later in the interiors of stars, which form much later in the universe. So it turns out that we know now that there is dark energy, copious amounts of dark energy. And what is dark energy? Dark energy, we think, is a repulsive force that is causing the accelerating expansion of the universe today. So it appears the universe has always been expanding, but it appears that in recent epochs, when I say epochs, I mean billions of years, right? So in the last 4 or 5 billion years, the universe has not only been expanding, but it's accelerating. And the force that is causing this acceleration, so gravity tends to attract, it tends to pull things together, so you need a counteracting force that pulls stuff apart to cause this accelerated expansion. And that mysterious repulsive force, and this should tell you already from the fact that I'm using, instead of using quantitative terms, I'm using qualitative, we know nothing about it, okay? We just know that there is a force that needs to be repulsive that is causing this expansion, accelerated expansion. So as far as dark matter is concerned, at the moment, there are some very plausible candidates. We think we might have some clue to which particle physics candidates are more viable. And there are many experiments ongoing, both direct and indirect detection, No results yet, but I think all promising, and it's very optimistic. The outlook is very optimistic. However, let me tell you that even if we don't know what this particle is made of, we can go a long way in trying to understand its possible properties by just knowing how it's distributed in the universe in detail. So let's move back to gravitational lensing, which is this technique exploiting the bending of light. So you have a distant galaxy, you can have a whole bunch of distant galaxies, right? Light from those distant galaxies is bent by the presence of mass. So it's really rather like geometrical optics, like optical lenses, concave and convex lenses that you might have all played with in school, where you have a candle, you have a screen, and you have a concave or a convex glass lens. Depending on the relative position between the candle and the lens, you can get all kinds of funky images. Sometimes you get a magnified image of the candle, sometimes you get an inverted image, sometimes you get a demagnified image. It just turns out in the universe, masses like glass in the lab acts as a lens, except that lenses can come in two shapes, concave and convex. In the universe, because mass is always positive, the light bending is always in one sense. So it turns out that the shapes of background galaxies, so galaxies here in the background have shapes, and they emit light. The light rays from those sources get bent by stuff along the line of sight. There's a lot of dark matter along the line of sight. So there's dark matter associated with individual galaxies. Individual galaxies have halos of dark matter, and clusters of galaxies, I just started out by telling you, are nature's largest repositories of dark matter. So the light bending effect is most dramatically seen by clusters of galaxies. So what you end up seeing is so there's a galaxy here, and light from this galaxy should actually gets bent due to the presence of this mass, and it follows this ray. So for an observer here on Earth, instead of seeing the real position, we end up seeing this galaxy at this other position. And then depending on how things line up, if this galaxy, the background galaxy, lines up just behind, right behind along the line of sight, you might end up seeing multiple images of the same galaxy. And I'll show you some beautiful examples of that. So the deflection of these light beams, which we can observe and we detect, that deflection is an angle that we can measure. And it turns out you don't need to worry about what all these symbols are. I mean, all that matters is that the strength of that deflection, the deflection is much more dramatic the more massive the lens. So you can, depending on how massive the lens is, the deflection angles are larger. So if you see a very large deflection, you know there's a lot of mass sitting here. And the strength of the deflection also depends on the geometry of the universe, because light rays ultimately are traversing through space-time. They are traveling through space-time from these sources to us. So any kink in the geometry, any kink in space-time will be reflected in the travel time of these light rays. It turns out that the deflections, therefore, that the large deflections, which we can measure, are very rich. They carry information both about the geometry of the universe and the mass distribution along the line of sight. So for the first part of the talk, I will show you one half of the game, which is we assume we know what the geometry of the universe is from other techniques, right? And we try to map all the matter in a cylinder along the line of sight from us to these distant galaxies that are getting distorted. And in the last half of the talk, I'll show you how you can switch the game around and say, well, let me try to simultaneously constrain both the geometry and the mass distribution and see what I get. And let's see how interesting that is. Now, how do you do that exercise and what are the new results? So to give you a better feel for what I mean by mass distribution and what are the kinds of effects when I say deflection, what it is that we actually see, I want to show you some possibilities, possible configurations, and the Hubble images that you get as a result of these configurations. So if you have a mass blob that's really a nice, smooth sphere, it turns out that's almost the case in the universe, right? But, and we are here on Earth, there's a distant galaxy. If you have a nice smooth bulb and light from this distant galaxy can, in some instances, actually get completely bent around, and instead of seeing this galaxy as a single ellipse, which is really what its true shape is, you end up seeing it completely deformed into something like that, into a C. Okay. You can in fact see it as a closed ring sometimes as well, and that's called an Einstein ring. However, the example that I show you here is one in which the ring is not complete, and these are real Hubble images. It turns out that the symmetry, how the mass is distributed in the cylinder along the line of sight from us, we are here along the line of sight from us to distant sources, has a very, very interesting and one-to-one effect on the kinds of images that are produced. Now, if the mass distribution, instead of being a sphere, is some kind of ellipsoid, so if it's a solid ellipse, and so you can see the difference in these two shapes, then you get a slightly different set of observed effects. So what you end up getting here now is not a continuous deformation into a C, but something that gets the same image gets split into four. And that's what we see here in these sort of bluish. They are four dots. These four dots are the same, are images of the same distant galaxy, of one galaxy gets quadruply imaged. How do we know it's the same galaxy? We can go and measure the spectrum of each of these blobs, and they're identical. The probability in the universe that any two random blobs have the same spectrum is practically zero. So we know that they're the same images, images of the same object. So it turns out, thankfully for us, and definitely for me, the universe is much more complicated than that, right? So the distribution of dark matter, it turns out, is a combination of one of these smooth distributions, as well as a lot of clumps. And it turns out that when the dark matter is very clumpy, and just for visualization, I've removed the blob here. You would have a nice smooth sphere, and on top of it, you would have all these clumps. And it turns out when you have these clumps, you get precisely what you see in Hubble Space Telescope images of clusters of galaxies. So this is to just show you, before we're all going to be in raptures with the Hubble images, but this is just to show you that the discovery of gravitational lenses was made with ground-based telescopes. And it took a long time for astrophysicists to convince the community that the distorted shape that you're seeing is actually, and the itsy-bitsy pieces that you're seeing all belong, are multiple images of the same object. So this is the lens that was the first discovered lens. It was actually discovered in 1988. And this is an image from the Canada-France-Hawaii telescope, which is in Hawaii. And notice, this is a highly distorted image of a single background galaxy. And this has a counter image on the other side, which is the second piece of this. So the two multiply imaged pieces of a single background galaxy. And what I'm showing you here is an animation which just shows you the kinds of effects you would get, the kinds of deformations, the range of deformations you can get. So nothing in the universe is actually moving. I'm just showing you various frames to show you various possibilities as a movie. So what you see here is a background screen, and the screen of galaxies are these blue dots, and they were all circular. Okay, if I did not put a cluster in front of it, they would all appear as circles to us. Okay, plopping a huge cluster with the kind of dark matter that we think clusters have, this is what it does to the shapes of background galaxies. So notice in the inner region, so this is where the mass is concentrated. Okay, most of the mass is sitting here. The densest part of the cluster is here. Notice you get this very dramatic lensing stretching. Okay. As you move further out, there is still an effect. There's nothing that looks like a circle anymore. Everything is elongated and stretched out. But there's a very systematic stretch out. You can see it's all stretched out along tangents to the center of this mass distribution. So we can detect at the moment, with the kind of resolution that Hubble offers us, all these ranges of distortions, a dramatic distortion as well as the tiny slight change in shape. So it turns out the most ordinary thing that really happens with the lens, with lensing, is a source that looks like a circle. So this is a galaxy. Let's assume it's spherical. So we see it projected on the sky as a circle. that gets elongated into an ellipse and it gets rotated a little bit. That's what lensing does. So you can think of lensing as some kind of filter that takes something that's a circle, stretches it out, and tweaks it, rotates it a little bit. Since it's mathematically well understood what exactly lensing does, we can actually calculate for any source, for any galaxy shape to start out with, how it should get distorted. Okay? And then what we do is we look at the data, we figure out which are the multiple images of the same object, and we run the problem backwards. We try to figure out what kind of clumpiness do we need to have in the cluster here in order to reproduce the observed images. So that's really what people like me have been doing for quite a while, for about 10 years now, since Hubble data has become available. So the thing to note here is that there are various ranges of effects. Not everything is dramatically distorted. Only light rays that pass through the densest part. So it turns out clusters are basically piled up dark matter. So there are these piles of dark matter. So light rays that penetrate through the densest part of the cluster get split into multiple images. But light rays that penetrate less dense parts of the cluster only get mildly tweaked. They only get stretched out a little bit. So there's a whole range of effects that you expect and that you actually do see. So let me try and also, given that, you know, it is sort of Hubble's birthday, I thought I should sort of show you why we are all so gushy about the Hubble. Astronomers and cosmologists are really gushy about the Hubble. Because, for example, this is a galaxy cluster, and here is a highly distorted arc, and it has counter images. You know, it has counter images somewhere here. It should have counter images, and this is a ground-based telescope image, again from the Canada-France Hawaii telescope. So I should point out here that the observations of gravitational lenses have really been led by the French in the early 80s, and it took a while to catch on in the US. So this is the same region of sky, the same cluster, imaged now with the Hubble Space Telescope. Just notice the clarity of this arc, how thin, how beautiful it is. You can even see little knots of star formation in this galaxy that has gotten stretched out. And it turns out that the counter images of this, the multiple images, are actually here, 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 and here. And this is an extremely distant galaxy. This tells you the redshift, so it tells you that this galaxy is actually at a distance away from us such that light from that galaxy actually takes about 4 billion years to get to us. Okay, so it's at a redshift of about 2. So to quickly give you a sense, okay, how do we know which are the highly distorted galaxies? As I said, it's a nice mathematical mapping, so we now understand. So this is just a projection on the sky to show you if you have a circular source that is sampling the densest part of this pile, which is a cluster, the cluster center. And as you move the source out, what are the kinds of image geometries you could get? So this is what you would observe. So a source that lines up just right gets imaged into these four blobs, as we saw in that real image before. What's interesting is, in addition to these magnified, turns out these blobs are actually magnified. And in fact, in the center, you produce another image, an additional image that is highly demagnified. So it's very hard to detect because it's very, very dim. But we have found it in some cases, and that is the true test of lensing hypothesis. So that's been verified. So this is my favorite, well, I don't know if it's my favorite cluster still, you know, it's been supplanted. But I like to often mention that this is sort of the Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie of galaxy clusters, you know, over-photographed and over-fetid. But it is beautiful regardless, right? It doesn't take away from the fact that this is beautiful. So this is the cluster that I just showed you, which was on my first slide, and we were zooming in on this region. So this... No. This is a cluster that is very distant from us. And through this cluster lens, we are seeing even more distant parts of the universe. So the cluster is almost like a telescope lens, which allows us to see even further behind. And because it magnifies things that are even further behind us, you end up seeing galaxies that you would normally never see. So the Milky Way, our galaxy, and where we are with respect to the, we're too close for any lensing by the Milky Way. So for lensing to happen, there has to be some distance between the lens, the object that's bending the light, and the sources of light. So these are extremely distant sources. So it turns out in this cluster, you see a plethora of highly distorted images. So you can all count them by eye now, because now you have a sense of how they occur. They occur sort of around a circle on the tangent, so you can pick them all out now. And you see there's a whole range, and it turns out there are about 100 images in this cluster, which we have found by just looking at these very, very high resolution Hubble Space Telescope images. So what you do is you identify what these arcs are, you identify which of them belong with each other. So there are families of them that occur. They occur in fours, sevens, eights, and so on and so forth. So you need to identify every piece, every multiple image counterpart for every piece that you see. And you need to go and measure the spectrum and to make sure that they are actually associated with each other and they all arise from the same source at the same location, same distant location. So from the inventory we have for this particular cluster, it appears that only 1% of the mass is in the stars in these galaxies that you see. These sort of fuzzy yellow things that you see are galaxies that are sitting in this cluster. So they're embedded in this sort of deep dark matter well, which we don't see, right? But we know the well exists because without the well, you would not have these distortions. There wouldn't be enough mass to cause the light bending. So the amount of light bending is telling us incontrovertibly that there has to be a lot of mass sitting there. There's no other way to stretch the stuff out the way we see it. And we see that 10% of the mass is actually in hot gas, which we don't see in this image, because this hot gas emits in the X-rays, and this is an optical image. And the rest is all dark matter. So about 90% of the mass in this object is basically dark matter. And to show you a couple of examples, so it's not just one object, but we have several dozens of these clusters now with very dramatic light bending. And so this is a particularly pretty one where you see a background galaxy, which in fact looks like a bicycle wheel. So it looks like the original shape appears to be something like this with, you know, all kinds of stuff happening here. And this is getting imaged into these stretched out pieces where you can actually detect the sort of ring in all five images. And they are marked by A, B, C, and D, and you'll see that they are actually... So notice that these images don't have to be identical to each other, okay? They all arise from the same source. They denote various amounts of distortion because the light rays have different paths and they encounter different amounts of dark matter. They are images of the same object that are similar, but they're not identical. Okay, there are differences between these images as well. And it also turns out that some of them will be magnified a little bit more than others. So just to show you, in the animation I showed you that you can detect the effect a large ways out, where you end up seeing some systematic change in the object, just a little stretching. So these red sticks show you the shapes, denote the shapes, the distortion in shapes as you move away from the center of a cluster. So you can think of the center of a cluster as a region where you have a lot of dark matter that's kind of piled. So when you're in the center, you see the most dramatic effect. So in the central region, that's where you see these highly distorted images. As light paths that penetrate through the less dense parts of the cluster, you only see weak distortions. But I want to show you that these weak distortions are real and they're measured by showing you these sticks. So this region, this is a zoom in of this region, okay? That's a zoom in of this region. And here we're going way out from the center of the cluster. So we're going way out from where the cluster pile is to the outskirts. And you still see a systematic distortion. And in fact, we use, for our purposes, we use a combination of the strongest stretching as well as the weak systematic stretchings to actually provide the inventory and the distribution of dark matter. So the regime where you get very, very strongly distorted multiple images, that's called strong lensing. The effect is very strong. Lensing is the light bending. And weak cleansing is really the areas here. So this is the regime of weak cleansing, and this is strong cleansing. So much of my work and my group's work has been trying to develop new and clever ways to try and combine these two effects, because they happen in the same cluster as you go. So you have to patch on the region where you find a lot of strong cleansing with region where you have weak cleansing. So what do we do? Well, yeah, a lot of these words are just for those of you who are probably slightly geeky and want to know the words. But in general, the principle is very, very simple. Okay, the principle really is we think that we are trying to provide a high resolution, like a sharpest possible mass distribution map for the cluster and its dark matter. So the hypothesis is, and it's very well supported by other observations, that this is a typical galaxy, okay? This is a galaxy that's sitting inside the cluster, okay? These are the bright blobs that we saw in the cluster image that I showed you. We think they have their own individual dark matter repositories around them. So these are the clumps. So we are trying to quantify how much of the dark matter in this cluster is distributed in that smooth blob that we saw earlier versus the clumps, okay? How much is really in clumps? And the effect of these clumps is to cause these weak distortions. Notice that these blue galaxies, these blue bits that you see here, are distant galaxies that are behind the cluster that are getting aligned preferentially, stretched out and weakly aligned along where there is mass. So we're just trying to quantify how big this halo is typically, so how big the clumps are, and how many of these clumps we actually have.
So how this the figure that you showed that is distinct entities?
Yeah, they are not that distinct. There's no such sharp edge for these dark matter clumps. However, there are concentrations, and I'll show you a visualization, and I'll show you a movie where it will become clearer why we conceive of them as sort of sharp silhouettes. So once again, so this is a movie from one of my colleagues who works in Zurich and has, luckily for him, the fastest supercomputer, access to one of the fastest supercomputers in the world, which I don't. However, the work is beautiful. So what it's showing you here is the formation of structure in the universe. So we started out with an initial condition where the universe was dominated by dark matter, and this dark matter had a few ripples in it to start out. So it's like the ocean with just a few ripples. And then you follow these ripples grow and they amplify because of gravity. So a ripple is really a region where you've concentrated, you have a little heap of dark matter and that has gravity, it attracts more stuff from around it and becomes a slightly bigger heap and so on and so forth. And the regions from which it's attracting stuff become devoid of dark matter. So they become these regions called voids. So what we just saw here is how a typical cluster of galaxies, I'll show the movie again, how a typical cluster of galaxies like that one assembles. So what is shown here are all dark matter particles. They're just mocked up to look like light, okay? So this is all dark matter. These are all dark matter blobs, okay? And they're all aggregating, they're merging, they're colliding because of gravity. So when two dark matter particles collide, what is really cool, because they don't stick to each other, they actually go past each other, okay? Because dark matter is supposed to be collisionless. We think it's collisionless. It doesn't actually collide with itself. And if it sticks only because of gravity, nothing else. Because remember, the gas, so the molecules in this room, right? So the perfume that all of us are wearing, right? Those molecules are sort of floating around. And they're going to hit the walls, and they're going to cause pressure, right? So, and they collide with each other, and they create pressure. It turns out dark matter has no pressure, so it never collides. So the only way dark matter aggregates, which we see here, is via gravity. So we now have a pretty good understanding of how structure forms in the universe, how you start off with those initial fluctuations, how they grow, and how this cluster forms. And what we'll end up seeing here at the end is a cluster that could look like this Abel 2218, this image that I've been flashing for you saying it was a beautiful cluster. This is sort of how a cluster like that assembles over cosmic time. And what you see here is a cosmic clock that's telling you how long it's taking for the structure to assemble.
And it turns out these clusters assemble very recently in the universe, since they are the most massive objects. So what you end up seeing, what you see here are all these dark matter blobs, okay? So what I have been trying to do along with my group is trying to see in this theory, so there's a theoretical prediction that says if you form a cluster that looks like that, okay? So a cluster which will look like this, it has two blobs, that's what we ended up, the last frame of the movie showed you two blobs and a lot of little pieces, right? We'll just see it one more time, partly because I love it. Secondly, it's just so visually beautiful. And secondly, you know, it's very, very instructive because I think it really makes the point. So you see a lot of these substructures, they're called, small-scale blobs, really, clumps. They merge, some of them disappear, but a huge number of them survive at the end, right? So theory, so this is a theoretical calculation, theory makes a very, very strong prediction for typically how many of these blobs, these little yellow dots that you see, that should survive. What you see in yellow there in the center is the smooth stuff. Okay, dark matter, but still smoothly distributed. So theory predicts precisely how many blobs we ought to have. And it turns out the nature of dark matter has a huge bearing on how many of these clumps survive. So for example, this is a simulation that me and one of my students did, where if the dark matter is this cold collisionless stuff, which I told you has no pressure, it doesn't collide at all, then you find a lot of itsy-bitsy pieces survive. Okay? The same time, the same universe with a dark matter particle that has a little bit of pressure that sticks. See how much smoother it is. It's the same region of the universe. So you can tell the difference by counting the number of blobs and in detail how many blobs you have, what the masses of those blobs are, where they are. You can actually discriminate between these two forms of dark matter. So as I'll show you results, our work has shown that this is not a dark matter candidate that is viable for our universe. And that this is the dark matter candidate, more complicated, more blobby one, is really a better description of what we see in the universe. How did we do that? So by looking at the lensing effect, so I've been showing you this cluster, illustrate the results that we have for this particular cluster. So as after using the light bending from the distorted images that we see, we can recreate the details of this lens that is doing the deformation. And this is what that lens looks like. So you have a smooth bump here of dark matter. So this is a dark matter map, a three-dimensional dark matter map. So you have a smooth lump here underneath, and on top of it, you have these little peaks, which are basically the blobs. And here, I've removed the smooth bump just to illustrate the blobs better, so you can see the blobs better. So what we can do now, with starting from a Hubble Space Telescope image, we can do the mathematical modeling using the distorted shapes of galaxies, knowing where those galaxies are. So we have their spectrum, so we know exactly where they are in three dimensions. We know where they are in space, we know where they are in distance from us. We can actually map the locations of all the blobs in these clusters. And here, we have not assumed anything further about the properties of our universe other than the fact that light propagates in it. Okay? We have not assumed that gravity is the only game in town, nothing. We have only assumed that light is bent by mass. And that is predicted by general relativity, which appears to hold rather well on these scales. And so we have now a map that tells us, that allows us to look at a particular region in the sky and say, okay, how many clumps do we have? Okay, and we can do an inventory of what the clumps are. And of course, the heights of these clumps tell you how massive these clumps are. Okay, so this axis is the mass of the clump, and this is the position of the clump. So the peakier a clump, the peakier, so this is the most massive clump in this cluster, and these are the second most massive clumps that you see in that pair. So what we can now do is go back and compare with the theoretical prediction, which is the movie that I just showed you. We can go look at a region of sky that is comparable to this cluster, size, and we can match the number of clumps. And it turns out that, as I said, it's cold dark matter theory that exactly matches the predicted clumps, as it turns out. So we can rule out from the light bending warm dark, so those dark matter candidates that have pressure, that are sticky, are called warm dark matter candidates, as opposed to cold dark matter candidates, which are collisionless. So we can conclusively rule those out. Okay. So I just want to show you.
So what are those classified as, the ones you rule out?
They're warm dark matter. They could be neutrinos. The particle, yeah, it is confusingly, the particle that we all think is viable is called the neutrino. So it sounds like a neutrino, but it's different. So neutrinos, which are these low mass, highly energetic particles that we know form in the universe. They also form in the lab, in lab experiments. They've been detected. We detect them from their absence, from the missing energy, because we know energy is conserved. So they have been detected. We know they exist. It appears that they cannot constitute the entirety of dark matter that is seen in the universe. Perhaps they contribute a small fraction of it, and that we can't discriminate, we can't say exactly what fraction, but from this work it appears that they cannot contribute even at the 5% level. So it turns out that, you know, this is just the background versus the contrast. Nothing deep there. It's just a choice of the background density. So it turns out that most of the universe, as we saw in that movie, has a sort of a thin web of dark matter is everywhere. There is some dark matter in this room, but there's just not enough. There's a very, it's so low density that, you know, I'll have to sit here for the entire age of the universe for one of those particles to actually go through my body. So that's why detection of these dark matter particles is so challenging. The rate at which dark matter particles are going through this library room is just, you know, tiny, tiny, tiny. So this green color is marked up just to show us that in the universe at large, there's sort of this veil of dark matter, those filaments that we saw, those webs that we saw earlier in that movie. And that's just the background. So on the background, there's always some sort of fuzzy, filamentary sort of amounts of dark matter. But the clustered regions, the regions that have clusters, are actually large stockpiles of dark matter in the universe. So this is just to show you another dark matter map. I love this visualization. So this is the dark matter map of a cluster going much further out than the previous map that I just showed you.
So this is, remember, the same cluster where we had the bicycle wheel galaxy. This is that one. And so that's the inner region, and these are the outskirts. Notice there are a lot of little clumps that we can find, that we do find, that exist on the outskirts as well of clusters. So now I'm going to move on to the last slides of my talk. Remember when I started out, I said that you can play the game two ways. You can try to constrain either the details of the mass distribution, or assuming you know the geometry of the universe, or you can say, well, let me try and see if I can do both things simultaneously with the observations. Can I say something about the nature of space-time and the curvature of space-time and the kinks, if any, in space-time, the geometry of the universe? Because light, the travel of light, is going to carry encoded in it the geometry of the universe, because light will travel and track the geometry of the universe, the geometry of space-time. So for that, we're going to use this cluster, which is yet another one. As I said, there are several dozens of these clusters with highly distorted lensed galaxies that are now seen. So this, in fact, is my favorite cluster. Well, you know, the favorite keeps moving, right, depending on which one, which cluster has the most data and, you know, what I can, the cluster out of which I can get most science out at any given time is my favorite. And then I very quickly move on. So it turns out that this particular cluster is super dramatic. It's dramatic in terms of the lensing effects. There are more than 200 multiply imaged pieces in this cluster from seen by the Hubble Space Telescope. And in fact, it is seen by the advanced camera of a surveys, which was a new camera that was put on the Hubble Space Telescope on with the repair mission, not this repair mission, the earlier repair mission. And in fact, in this repair mission,
a battery
was added on to this camera to ensure its longevity. So it turned out that this cluster has 32 different galaxies behind. We know where they are, that are multiply imaged into 3s, 4s, 5s, 6s. Okay? And we know exactly where those sources are. And in fact, for 19 sets of those, 19 sets of families, so I'm going to call this a family. So when we observe these arcs around the center, so that's one family. And so this particular cluster has 19 such families detected. And we know exactly where they are. And so what is the game now? Now this is the game. So this is the modification, slight modification of the picture that you saw earlier, where I just showed you one galaxy that gets multiply imaged. So what we end up seeing, right, because everything is projected on the sky, it's two-dimensional, if you have a lot of different sources, and in this particular case, I told you there are about 19 chaps behind the cluster that are all getting multiply imaged into 3 bits, 4 bits, and so on and so forth, right? What we end up seeing, of course, is the superposition, is the sum of all of them. But we know, because we have their spectra, we know exactly where they are. So we know one of them is here, the second one is there, the third one is there, etc., etc. So because light paths from each of these different sources have traveled different lengths, they have sampled very different parts of space-time, because they are traveling through space-time. And just to point out, space-time, the way we think about, cosmologists think about space, we actually think of space-time as a sheet. It's sort of this fabric. And we call it space-time because to understand when an event happened in the universe, we need to know not only where it happened, so you need, you know, the exact location, so three coordinates, three numbers to tell you X, Y, and Z of where it happened, whether it happened in this part of the room or there. But in the universe, because of the scale of distances involved and the fact that even though light travels very fast, it takes a finite amount of time to get to us, you need to specify when something happened. So for example, you might all know that the sun, which is our nearest star, it takes 8 minutes for light to reach us from the sun. So if the sun dies, for 8 minutes we won't know, right? So you can imagine, right, the sun is our nearest star. So any change happens will take us 8 minutes. Similarly, the light we are seeing from the sun right now left the sun 8 minutes ago. So, and that's our closest star. So these distant galaxies, actually light takes millions of years, if not billions of years, to reach us. So it's kind of fascinating that in a way we are, when we go out into the night sky and we're looking at all these distorted images and everything, we are seeing the light that left, we are seeing the universe as it was, not as it is, right? But that's all we have. So anyway, it turns out that you could then use the fact that the light beams from these various sources at various distances have originated and sampled different amounts of space-time to get to us. And we can use that. So this is the inner region of the cluster, and this is in yellow is marked a region of the cluster behind which anytime you have a source, it'll get multiply imaged. So this marks out the strong lensing regime of this cluster. Okay? And it turns out that, you know, what we get in terms of constraints are that this is a measure of dark energy, this axis, and this is a measure of the total mass inventory of the universe. And from what I told you, from other techniques we know, other independent techniques that do not assume anything about lensing or light travel, we know that our universe corresponds to roughly sort of this location, somewhere here. Where this number, which measures the total mass fraction of the universe, is 0.3. So 30% is the total matter content of the universe, and 0.7 is dark energy. That 0.7 corresponds to this number W being -1. So it turns out that our universe from supernovae, the discovery of the accelerating universe, suggests that the relevant parameters are here. So note that this is a completely different method, and we are getting a very, very interesting answer that is in very good consonance with that result. And so there are, of course, limitations. You may ask, oh, this is great, this is a new technique. So I want to mention that the results that I just showed are in progress. They are being considered by science as well, and we're waiting for the final referee's report. We've gone back and forth a couple of times, and I'm really hoping it should be out in a month or so. So it turns out that the limitations for this technique, and you, if you think about it, you might have just figured it out right away that, you know, you have a lens here, and I'm trying to model the lens. And it matters what other blobs that are not, we've been modeling all the blobs that are sitting inside the lens. Clearly, if they're of consequence, blobs behind the lens are going to be of consequence. So it turns out we really, really need to understand quite well how many galaxies lie behind the cluster that may not actually get, whose light may not get bent, but they actually participate as little lenses. So you have a main lens here, the cluster, and you have a lot of little potential lenses along the line of sight. So we need to understand, typically in the universe, when we look at a region that has a cluster of galaxies and has these dramatically distorted arcs, how many other things, blobs, can lie behind that cylinder? It turns out, theoretically, we have a very, very good idea of how much stuff there should be along a typical line of sight out in the universe. So this is just to tell those of you who might be interested in knowing what is the future. So, you know, beyond Hubble, what are we going to do? What's going to happen if Hubble suddenly dies, right? So it turns out that there are things we can do from the ground. But at the moment, of course, you know, we are collecting as much imaging data as we possibly can with the Hubble. And we're going to follow up. So there are many, many surveys, so huge surveys of swaths of the sky that are ongoing. Some of them are ongoing, and some of them are going to be set up with special telescopes that are being built, very large aperture telescopes that can collect a huge amount of light and therefore access very distant galaxies. So, you know, I think for strong lensing, which is what I talked about here, we really do need data from space. And so, you know, the Hubble is our best bet, and it turns out that future space telescope, there is a future space telescope that is being planned by the Europeans. It's called Euclid, and the Americans may end up joining it. It's not clear at the moment. I mean, there just is no money for basic sciences. It is unclear what the funding directions are going to be. But, you know, the in terms of what important and interesting constraints on dark matter and our current understanding of dark matter, these observations and this kind of analysis provides, it's really invaluable. So it turns out that, you know, because it is not so easy to detect dark matter particles directly, we may end up having to really understand much better the potential constraints on their properties from these sort of indirect methods like strong lensing. So, and I think that the power of this technique, so the standard model that describes the universe, the standard paradigm is called lambda CDM. CDM stands for cold dark matter, and lambda stands for this dark energy, this piece that we think powers the accelerating expansion of the universe. So that seems to be the model that our universe fits best at the moment. It turns out that Einstein's equations, which for the first time proceeded to model the universe as an empty in an equation. Okay, so that was his, so his profound insight was the fact that the geometry, the contents, and the fate of the universe are intricately linked. So if you know any two, you know the third. And his equations predict that there are only three possible solutions for what our universe could look like. And they correspond, therefore, to three different geometries. One in which space-time is flat, one in which space-time is curved positively, like the surface of a sphere, one in which it's negatively curved, like a saddle. So So those are the only three possibilities. And it appears now that we have a very, very good idea of both the fate. So it turns out that a universe can keep expanding forever. It can expand and then go back and crunch on itself. Or it can expand and coast at a constant speed. It turns out that we happen to be on the solution where the universe is expanding but accelerating, and that we have a geometry that is overall flat. Although when you look at small scales, there are lots of kinks in space-time. On very large scales, the universe is flat.
Can it be a cyclical process? Like now it's, you're saying it's accelerating expansion.
Right. So that's an excellent question. So it turns out that the current acceleration phase actually did happen once in the early universe. So very early in the universe, 10 to the minus 43 seconds after the Big Bang. Okay, how do we know that? You know, ask me offline and I can tell you that. We actually know it's quite accurately, it's 10 to the minus 43 seconds. So 10 to the minus 43 seconds after the Big Bang, the universe went through this kind of spurt, expansion spurt that was accelerating, and that was called inflation. It was a very exponential expansion, okay? And then it stopped, and then it started expanding at a constant rate. And this is the second time that it's kind of gone a little berserk and taken off accelerating. So there are theories, as I said, we don't understand what dark energy is. There are theories where people think that this is a part of a cycle, and that, you know, what we are seeing now is some second kind of inflation that is driven by some particle physics phenomena, and that, you know, this is going to replicate. But, you know, we have no observational evidence to ratify any of these models. There are lots of very, very interesting ideas to solve both these problems of what exactly the dark matter particle is and what the dark energy is. And there are actually some very interesting ideas where they're combined. These two dark entities are combined. There's a unified physics that can kind of explain both the dark matter and the dark energy. So I think I'll just stop here. And please feel free to ask me more questions. Oh, you mean I think you could compare it to Galileo assembling his first telescope and looking at the moons. I think it is as transformative, because I think, you know, it has allowed us to access timescales, epochs, and distances that were hitherto unimaginable. So it is really the kind of shift. I don't want to use the word paradigm shift because it's used all the time for all kinds of things. But I think it's transformative in quite the same way in our conception. You know, in our conception of our place in the universe, I think it is as transformative as Galileo's. So
I'm just trying to understand gravitational lensing. So undistorted images of galaxies, would that mean that there's no clump of dark matter? Dark material between us and that.
Yes.
Okay. And how much does, how far do you have to move this cylinder of line of sight to confirm those angles?
Right. So it turns out that most, if you go out and look at the night sky, a very, very small covering area of the night sky actually has clusters. So much of the swath of the night sky that you see and the shapes that you see for galaxies are actually undistorted. And it's very, very small regions. Because we understand how structure formation works, we know that a very, very small portion of the sky is actually covered in the densest regions of dark matter. So moving just off the cluster, just a little bit off the cluster, you actually know that there are no distortions, because that is the vast majority of the sky. And in fact, that is how, because we can calibrate off the rest of the sky, that's how we know how strong the distortions are. Because you go off the center of a cluster and you look at the shapes, and that's the prior distribution that you use to calibrate how distorted you actually are getting because of the presence of a cluster.
Is there a cluster of dark material?
With no galaxies?
Yeah.
Not yet detected. There are always claims when people say, we found this dark lens, and then you point the Hubble and you sit on it and you see some galaxies. So it has never turned out that there is an entirely dark clump with no stars that have formed yet in it that have been detected at these cosmic distances.
But that, if you found one, that would give you some indication of how our universe.
No, but what, you know, I think if you found a cluster, like a clump of dark matter with no stars associated with it, I think unfortunately it will tell us less about dark matter and more about the physics of star formation, which is very, very complicated. But the problem, stars form when gas cools and forms very dense clumps, and it becomes colder and colder, denser and denser, and then you eventually form a star. Finding a dark matter clump with no stars probably tells you that for some reason the gas from which the stars need to form is unable to cool, which means it's being kept hot somehow, or it doesn't exist. There isn't, as I said, the way to think about dark matter is to think of it as potential wells, as buckets. And, if these buckets don't have any ordinary atoms, gas that have fallen into them, they'll never form stars. And it's possible that there are some such regions in the universe where gas just hasn't accumulated in these dark matter buckets, if you will. Just from lensing, but we haven't detected any such thing yet.
So they wouldn't really know that there's dark matter there unless there's something in it.
No, but there'll be stuff behind it, right, that can get distorted, right? Yeah. So all I'm saying is we haven't found a region where you don't already see fuzzy galaxies. So these are all gravitational lenses with highly distorted arcs. This is actually a survey from a ground-based telescope. And see, you can see some of these very dramatic lenses. So, these fuzzy galaxies that you see, they're all part of the cluster. So they're all embedded, they're, as I said, I think the bucket maybe is a reasonable analogy. See, if there's like dark matter bucket and these guys are sitting in it. So we are yet to detect an image of a highly distorted galaxy like this without these fuzzy blob cluster galaxies. If we did, that would be interesting. And as I said, there, often every 5 years there's a claim that we detected one, and then you look deeper and use, look with the best telescopes for longer, and you find some very faint fuzzy blobs that start to show up.
Yep. You mentioned that at 10^43 seconds after the Big Bang,
-43 seconds
after the Big Bang, there had been a sudden inflation. Was that before or after the point at which the expanding galaxy?
Oh, this is well before any galaxies formed. So we think that the first galaxies in the universe likely formed when the universe was about 6 to 7 giga years old.
That's the first subatomic particles.
Pardon?
The point where the expanding mass cooled enough for subatomic particles such as gluons to form.
Right, so we think this is before that. Inflation, we think, is prior to any kind of baryogenesis, any kind of quarks, gluon, before there was even plasma. Yeah.
I know gravity isn't all that strong, but what does that all mean in relationship?
Right. So as I said, we don't quite know how exactly dark energy operates. Like, we know how gravity operates, right? So if you have two masses, there's a force of it kept at some distance away from each other. We know what the gravitational force is, attractive force. It's always attractive, and we know what it is between these two masses, and we know what the force of gravity will tend to do. It will tend to cause these two masses to move towards each other. And, as they move towards each other, the force gets stronger because it's inversely proportional to the distance squared. The distance goes down, it gets stronger, right? And it's always attractive. It turns out when people say, and when we say that dark energy counteracts gravity, it turns out that dark energy causes a force that is equivalent to a repulsive force. And so it's almost like stretching out or increasing the distance, if you will, but that's not quite what's happening. But it's happening to space-time. It's not happening to objects. So dark energy, so you can think of space-time as a sheet and the presence of every mass. So you imagine holding up the edges of a sheet. Well, the universe has no edge, but let's just think about four people holding the edges of a sheet and you drop a football into it. So if you look at the side view, you see a little kink in that sheet, right? So that's what mass does to the universe. It turns out dark energy causes the sheet to expand out quite rapidly. Right. And it can compensate. So that's the sense in which it compensates, because if it keeps expanding and you pull the sheet out, that little kink will become softer and softer, and at once it's stretched out incredibly, there is no kink to be seen, even though there's the football there. So that's the sense in which it counteracts gravity. No, they're not at all evenly distributed. Actually, it turns out that matter in the universe clusters, so clusters cluster. So there are regions in the universe, as I said, part of why they cluster is that the initial fluctuations in the universe, I'll draw in this corner. So basically the density fluctuations in dark matter, you can think of it like sand piles. So the dark matter, so there were regions where the dark matter was piled up in sand piles, and there are regions where there are troughs, there's not enough dark matter. So there's an excess in some places, there's a deficit. As time goes on, this excess grows, this deficit grows. And this happens due to gravity. So these are piles that will actually grow in time, become bigger and bigger. And these regions will become devoid, more and more devoid of matter. So these regions, nearby regions where you have a lot of stuff accumulated, will actually cluster, and those are regions that will form galaxies and clusters and so on and so forth. So the distribution of clusters is dictated by what those initial fluctuations in the sand pile were. We know what they are, and that is not uniform, so there isn't a uniform distribution of clusters. I wish I could go back and show you. I'd probably have to dig out. Actually, this is a very good question. I think I should try and show you a slide from my class, if I can find it.
So while you're looking for that, I have a question.
Please.
The material from those troughs, is that going to the piles?
Yes, it's being evacuated. So those piles are being evacuated. So actually, this is the slide I want to show you. So this is the distribution of galaxies in the universe, galaxies and clusters. Each dot there represents either a galaxy or a cluster. Notice that this is not uniform. So it's spongy, it has some kind of sponge. Notice that there are regions where you have a lot of clustering, so a lot of dark bits tell you that there's a lot of clustering. And these are the regions that are the voids. So you see these gaps? So those will be the regions that I keep telling you here will not have much matter. So those are sort of these void regions. And you can see some of them even amongst all the dense structure. See these little regions that are voids. So in fact, it turns out that this is not random. So if you actually do statistical analysis, you can figure out what the pattern is, how to describe the pattern, this web. And this clustering pattern be described, and it is pretty well described. So it's a slightly different pattern for galaxies and for clusters of galaxies. It's not homogeneous. So I think you can see it here. Yeah. One more question.
Are there any current theories in the works on how dark matter, dark energy would affect the idea from Einstein's theories that gravity in a certain area will affect the dilation of time?
Right. So I think that's a very good question. In fact, there's a lot of very interesting work still in very nascent stages where people are trying to modify not Newton's laws necessarily, but general relativity. So Einstein's equations, trying to modify the relationship between gravity and space-time. This whole idea of the mass causing a bump in space-time, etc. So there's a lot of active work at the moment. None of it is mature enough to actually be testable in terms of predictions at the moment, but some very interesting directions that people are following. And I wouldn't be surprised if, you know, in another 5 years or so, we have a mathematical formulation that is an alternative to Einstein's, in which, for example, it may turn out that the light bending doesn't work quite the same way, that it works out differently. Because light paths have to do with, as I said, it's the travel time of these bent paths that's different, and you see the shapes that are distorted. In fact, if a background galaxy is twinkling, has its own variability, because of some reason it's changing, the light output from that is changing, then because the light travel times are different to each of these multiple images, you can detect. You know, so if you see, if there's a galaxy that actually has its light output that is varying instead of a steady output coming out, right? So it's varying with some on some time scale. These multiple images, because they have different light travel paths and therefore different light travel times, it turns out that one of the images may look like this and the other guy may look shifted. Okay? Shifted away, shifted the same curve, but slightly shifted in time. Those are detected. So it turns out that those can be explained at the moment. What we see can be explained with Einstein's theory, but it may turn out that there are sort of complex phenomena there that we may be able to detect better in the future that will allow us to discriminate those new models from Einstein's theories. So yes, so gravitational lensing really is the most powerful tool. It turns out it's the reason it's such a powerful tool is that I know you've had a couple of astronomy-related talks where people have probably talked to you about the formation of galaxies and star formation. That's all very complicated physics. So it turns out that the light bending is done by mass. It doesn't matter if the mass there is the stars or dark matter, right? Because that's what allows us to map the dark matter. So we are making no assumption about how galaxies form when we're calculating the lensing. So that's why it's so powerful. So it's not contaminated by our lack of knowledge of how stars form and how they age and how they fade and so on and so forth. That's kind of inconsequential in a way to the light bending, because as long as there's mass, there's light bending. It doesn't matter if that mass is all stars or it's all dark matter, right? As we just saw, it tends to be all dark matter anyway. And please feel free to send me email. You can find me on my webpage.